The Philippine branch of the Dutch lender ING expects sustainable financing to continue gaining ground in the country. ING Philippines notes an increase in recent years of loans and bonds, as well as other financial market offerings from banks that have pro-environment elements. The lender says it is focused on helping fund green projects in key sectors such as energy, infrastructure, and agriculture. ING Philippines also vows continued support for sustainability initiatives of the private sector and the government.
Also been an increase in the number of investors that are quite conscious about sustainability. In fact, the Philippines ranks number 2 in terms of ASEAN, in terms of number of investors that are interested in sustainability. With interest from investors, it also becomes more profitable for banks. We're very focused in supporting the Philippines in its growth ambitions. The Philippines is a growth market for ING, and we continue to invest and support our clients and the national government in these initiatives, capitalizing on ING's strength in our global network, and of course, our experience in the sustainability space.
Some corporate stories. Alternergy secures an 8 billion peso loan from banks. The borrowing from BPI and Security Bank is to help fund the construction of its wind project in Tanay, Rizal. The project is targeted to be completed by next year. Meanwhile, Bloomberg Resorts dismisses as mere speculations a report that said it is eyeing to expand operations to Thailand. The operator of the Solaire Resort and Casino, and recently of Solaire North, told the local boards there is no such plan. It responded to query from an online report which said Bloom is monitoring Thailand's efforts to legalize casinos for a boost in revenues.
Denise Insay now joins us with a story from the Banco Central and the latest corporate news. Hi, Denise.
Hi, Stanley. An external survey by the Philippine Central Bank shows analysts expect its monetary easing to last until 2026. The BSP's monetary policy report this month found watchers project a quarter point cut by the end of the year. They expect the benchmark rate to be slashed by another 25 basis points for 2025 and ultimately by 50 the year after that. The moves would bring the BSP's key rate, which is currently at a near 17-year high of 6.5%, to 5.5%. This is, of course, contingent with inflation expectations of 3.7% by the year end. Analysts see the measure of consumer prices settling at 3.5%, both in 2025 and in 2026.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. arrives in Brunei for his first state visit to the second richest country in Southeast Asia. Marcos says the push will be for deeper cooperation with Brunei, specifically on defense, tourism, and agriculture. He is set to meet with Sultan Hassan al-Bolkiah. While there, Marcos will also pitch for the Philippines to be an investment destination.
I am confident that our partnership with Brunei in these important sectors will further bolster our political, economic, and people-to-people ties. I look forward to securing investments that will generate more jobs, contribute to poverty alleviation, and accelerate the economic transformation of our country.
Marcos heads to Singapore next, where he will deliver a keynote address at the annual Shangri-La Dialogue centering on security and defense. The death toll due to Typhoon Naghon in Quezon Province climbs to 6. Local police said the 2 new fatalities died in Lucena City, while the other drowned in Mauban. The country's disaster management agency earlier reported another death, a teenager who was crushed by a toppled tree in Misamis Oriental. The Agriculture Department said initial damage by the typhoon to crops is at 11.8 million pesos. Prior to leaving for Brunei, President Marcos assured typhoon-ravaged areas, help is on the way.
Kagaya ng dati, lahat ng aming ginagawa in coordination, siyempre ang first responder lagi dyan, ang ating mga LGU. Kaya as usual, they have brought all their energies together at the very first instance. At nasa bayan naman, nasundan kaagad ng national government sa pamamagitan ng pagbigay ng assistance, pagbigay rescue, search and rescue na ginawa. Hindi natin titigilan ito, siyempre, hanggang matapos ang ating pagtulong sa mga nasalanta, sa mga naging biktima dito sa ating mga area na tinamaan ng agon.
A Philippine House lawmaker slamming China's fishing ban in parts of the West Philippine Sea, as well as its order to the Chinese Coast Guard to arrest foreign trespassers beginning June 15. Zambales 1st District Representative Jay Kong-hun rejects Beijing's claim that its fishing ban is meant to preserve marine life. He asserts China is actually the one behind the environmental degradation in the disputed territory. Kong-hun also calling on the Coast Guard and the military to protect Filipino fisher folk.
Siyempre, natatakot tayo para sa kanila dahil ito toong buhay na, no? Talagang kanilang kabuhayan yung nakasalalay dito. Yan ang ginagamit nila upang pakainin yung kanilang pamilya, bigyan ng magandang kinabukasan yung kanilang mga anak. At talagang sana nananawagan tayo sa ating Philippine Coast Guard, ating mga sundaluhan, na protektahan sana yung ating ano, no, yung ating mga mangingisda, lalong-lalo na dumalaot sa West Philippine Sea.
Congressman Kong-hun also questioned the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources' use of its funds. He says the BFAR should do more for local fishermen other than donating small, manually powered boats. A group of fishermen in the West Philippine Sea unfazed by China's fishing ban, according to Leonardo Quaresma, president of the new Masinloc Fishermen Association. This is just one of the many threats they face every day. He also tells the Philippine government instead of sending aid, which only lasts a couple of days, the government should walk the talk and actually do security patrols in the disputed waters.
Kung sila ay tutulong sa amin, kailangan namin yung matatag na hanap buhay ng bawat sambayanan nating mga Pilipinong nangingisda. At hindi yung pansamantala lang na pangangailangan. Tingin ko po ay paigtingin yung kanilang pagpapatrulya sa ating pong karagatan, sapagkat sinasabi nila na madalas na tuwing may pumapalawag daw ng mga mangingisda ay ni-escortan ito ng mga Coast Guard natin. Nandiyan daw yung ating mga Navy, nandiyan daw yung mga BFAR. Pero ang totoo niyan, mula po nung nagkaroon ng suliranin sa ating karagatan sa West Philippine Sea, mula po nung pumapalawag kami, wala pa naman kaming nakita na in-escortan na isa man sa ating pong mga mangingisda.
The National Food Authority assures the public of ample rice supply for the looming La Nina phenomenon. This as the NFA's rice buffer stock tripled because of its new pricing scheme. NFA warehouses secured 2.8 million bags of palay with its higher buying price range set at 17 to 23 pesos per kilogram of fresh or wet palay and 23 to 30 pesos per kilo of clean and dry palay. The procurement of more palay is ongoing to secure the NFA's target of 300,000 metric tons of rice buffer stock. The Philippines is expected to experience La Nina in the second half of the year.
Pagdating naman dito sa La Nina, no, yung stocks natin ay enough, and at the same time, meron na rin po tayong mga naibigay sa DSWD na nag-prepositioning na po sila. So marami na po tayo naibigay doon. And at the same time sa mga LGUs na nakahingi rin po due to El Nino, nabigyan na po natin sila dyan. Ang stocks naman po ng bigas o yung supply ng bigas sa Pilipinas, marami naman po talaga na nasa private sector, nasa household. So wala po tayong nakikitang hindi sasapat ang ating supply at ang ating buffer stock.
The President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. signs the so-called Eddie Garcia Law. Republic Act 11996 seeks the protection and ensures the welfare of workers in the movie and television industry. It provides for the implementation of work hours, wages, and benefits, as well as health and safety standards in the workplace. The measure was named after the late veteran actor Eddie Garcia, who died in June 2019. The 90-year-old actor suffered a neck injury after he tripped and fell while shooting for an upcoming project.
Filipino tycoon Ramon Ang urges the Marcos administration to pull down power prices in the country by protecting oil reserves in the West Philippine Sea. Ang says the Philippines should safeguard its territories as other Southeast Asian countries ramp up oil production.
Our neighboring countries are still subsidizing heavily on fuel and power. Why are they able to do it? Because Malaysia has its own oil production. Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, Vietnam. We, our oil production is only 6,000 barrels per day compared to our neighboring countries' average 1 million barrels a day. That's why they can put in subsidy. Philippines, we don't have oil. But we have a very big reserve in West Philippine Sea. That's why they are very interested on the Philippines. So let us not let go of it. We should protect our territory.
The San Miguel Corporation CEO gave those remarks during an economic forum. Socioeconomic Secretary Arsenio Balisapan did not comment on protecting the country's interests in the West Philippine Sea, but he did say government has no plans to subsidize oil.
I think we should avoid subsidizing power, electricity, fuels generally, no? Because the biggest consumers of fuels, for example, are the rich. The biggest consumers of electricity are the rich. So if you subsidize those, who benefits?
Following Ramon Ang's call, the Philippine Energy Department admits it needs investors' help in exploring the West Philippine Sea and other oil-rich areas to boost Manila's energy sector. The Philippines has long sought to drill natural gas from the Reed Bank, which was found to contain 5.4 billion barrels of oil, or about twice as much as what was found in Malampaya. However, Manila's long-standing maritime row with Beijing has stalled any developments.
Everywhere in the Philippines, we need to explore. As long as there are potentials, we need to do it. We have to invite all possible investors to do it for us because the government alone cannot do it. As far as those that have been found and identified, yes, we have lower reserves than Vietnam or even other ASEAN countries.
Yeah.
But we are very hopeful the geology of the Philippines must offer the potentials for natural gas and other liquid fuels.
Philippine economic managers allay concerns about the peso's depreciation against the greenback as the local currency continues to hover at the 58 to the dollar level. Katrina Domingo reports.
The Banco Central ng Pilipinas assures the public that the Philippine peso's weakness against the U.S. dollar is only temporary. It says the country's macroeconomic fundamentals remain firm despite global headwinds.
Only temporary, and eventually, once things clear up, it will be the fundamental that will determine the level of exchange rate. Also look at what's happening around the area. Are we the only ones depreciating or not?
The central bank adds, while the Philippines does not target any specific exchange rate level, the government is keeping a close eye at market stresses.
If we let the market stress to be left unattended, this would affect inflation expectation, and that's something that we are avoiding.
The Philippine peso continues to hover at the 58 to the dollar level after touching 58.27 last week, its lowest since November 2022. The International Monetary Fund says foreign exchange flexibility should be a priority of central banks and that monetary and fiscal decisions should be data dependent and driven by domestic considerations.
It's the combination of foreign exchange flexibility with a credible inflation targeting regime that really matters, and to anchor expectations of investors. And what we've seen in the Philippines in recent years is that this combination of foreign exchange flexibility with the credible inflation targeting regime. So I think we have to hold the line on that front and combining flexibility on the foreign exchange rate regime with a continued commitment to ensure price stability.
Meanwhile, Finance Chief Ralph Recto echoes the dovish tone of the central bank, saying a rate cut is still possible this year.
But yes, it seems like inflation is going down. It used to be about 8.2%. It's down to 3.8%. It's well within the 2 to 4% band. So it's possible that you may have a rate cut this year and possibly more rate cuts next year. Surely, I don't expect interest rates to go any higher.
BSP Governor Eli Remolona earlier hinted at a possible rate cut in August, while Recto projects a 150 basis point rate cut in the next few years. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine ICT Department rules out banning TikTok in the country. This follows calls to block access to the short-form video app here at home and in the U.S. over its ties to China. Jackie Pascual reports.
The Department of Information and Communications Technology is not in favor of banning social media platform TikTok, at least for now. At a public briefing of the new National Cybersecurity Plan, Undersecretary Jeffrey D. said they would prefer to regulate social media sites and over-the-top or OTT messaging apps instead. To regulate, he said, would mean to check if these platforms follow Philippine laws on privacy, cybersecurity, and other policies. Currently, DICT has no mandate to regulate social media apps.
We are in support of regulation of OTTs and social media platforms, especially in their following our rules on privacy, our rules on cybersecurity, our rules on computer security. Yung banning, I think, is in the form of maximum penalty of regulation. Hindi lang TikTok po, no? We're not singling out a particular application.
Manila Representative Bienvenido Abante Jr. has earlier filed a bill seeking to prohibit foreign adversary-controlled mobile applications like Chinese-owned TikTok. He asserted that TikTok may get sensitive information from Filipinos or the app may be used to spread misinformation. But D said they do not want to ban any legitimate apps, but they just would like to review the terms and conditions of these online services, which the public usually does not really read.
So somebody has to act as a controller, diba? Acting in behalf of the welfare of the public. That could be government through regulation. Para ipasok natin yung mga tanggalin at ipasok at i-regulate nga yung mga terms and conditions regarding the use of our private data.
DICT supports a cybersecurity bill and other similar policies for them to regulate apps. DICT will also strengthen the country's cybersecurity efforts with the new National Cybersecurity Plan 2023 to 2028.
This is a whole of nation approach. We provide technical support. We provide technical advisories. The entire government must be on the same page paano mag-implement ng cybersecurity defenses.
Cyber threat actors continue to conduct their activities in more nefarious ways. Ransomware attacks continue to threaten every security institutions or organizations, leading to the disruption of critical public services.
This year alone, DICT has recorded over 1,000 cyber incidents affecting government sites, mostly minor cases, but 14 classified as critical. DICT also urges government to join the National Cybersecurity Operations Center to help combat cyber threats together. Out of over 200 government agencies, only 28 are connected to the said center. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Internal Revenue Bureau opened to addressing concern on recent changes in the process of paying taxes. These include extending the deadline on the submission of inventory for unused official receipts, which lapsed yesterday. Vivian Gulia with details.
The Bureau of Internal Revenue Office in Quezon City was busy on Monday as value-added tax registered persons and businesses seek to beat the May 27 deadline for the filing of inventory of unused official receipts. This is pursuant to the implementation of the Ease of Paying Taxes Law, which harmonizes the rules on VAT treatment for the sale of goods and services, requiring sales invoice for both instead of official receipts for services sold. The threshold for issuing duly registered invoices increased to 500 pesos from 100 pesos. Taxpayers, however, may still use their remaining official receipts as invoice until December 31, 2024, or the end of the year if they submit an inventory not later than May 27. They will just have to strike through the phrase official receipt on the document and stamp the word invoice before issuing it. A tax advisor urges the government to extend the May 27 deadline for the submission of inventory. The BIR chief says he is open to it.
Kapag meron kang 100 branches, bawat branch magsasubmit ng inventory report. So sana palawigin yung deadline, sana gawing online para hindi na manumanong gagawin ng ating mga kababayan.
I-extend po natin. Nakita naman natin na marami po tayong mga taxpayers na pumupunta sa opisina at hindi pa nakakapag-comply. So kaya binibigyan pa natin sila ng panahon.
Some businesses also appeal for the extension of the December 31 validity of unused official receipts. The BIR chief says the matter is under consideration by the agency.
At least next year, sana half year pa next year para mas maraming ano. Kasi syempre yung cost din ng pagpapaprint, tapos kung marami pa kayong unused.
Pinag-aaralan po natin yan na tinitingnan po natin na wala na po tayong gagawing deadline, kundi hanggang maubos po ang official receipts para naman hindi naman masayang ang mga naimprintang official receipts. So basta sumunod lang po dun sa guidelines na itinakda po kung paano i-convert itong official receipts na naimprinta na to sales, to an invoice.
Despite these issues, the BIR asserts the Ease of Paying Taxes Law benefits taxpayers by removing the 500 peso annual registration fee, reducing the income tax return pages for micro and small taxpayers, and allowing taxpayers to register either electronically or manually. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.